Hello there and welcome to another KCM Lite, the online service for King's Church Mildenhall. We're glad you could join us again. We do miss not being able to meet up together and hope it won't be too long before we can start to do that in the future, but we do pray that God is watching over you and that you might know his blessing and that something of his spirit upon us, and particularly as we seek to communicate and to share worship together digitally in this online service. May you know God's blessing and God's nearness. Keep on keeping on in him. We've got something we just want to remind you of. For those of you who are church members, we did communicate with you before Christmas about something that we're looking to seek God's will about for us to enter into as a church. To do with community money advice, a debt help service, CMA. And we did send some stuff out to you and we asked you to pray about it. And we did say that in the new year, in the first part of the new year, that we'd be looking to make a decision on this and to seek God's will as a church, as if this is a ministry that we want to undertake. Well, that time is coming rapidly. We will have normally had a church members meeting at the end of January, but obviously because of the current circumstances, we're not able to do that. But you will be hearing from us soon, if you're a church member, as to how we're going to go about seeking God's will as to whether we go forward with this CMA project. So please be continuing in prayer for this, and make sure you look out for a communication from us, which will be coming early this next week. I'm going to invite you now, just as we enter into this time of worship, just to be still. Maybe just close your eyes and let's offer ourselves to God in prayer. Let us pray. Father, for all your blessings, we thank you. For all your goodness, we thank you. For everything that comes to us in our life, Lord, that is a reflection of your love and your grace and your mercy. And Father, we just ask in this time of worship that we spend together, through the songs that we sing, the prayers that are prayed, through the scriptures that are read and proclaimed, Lord, we pray that you might draw near to us and that you might get hold of us and shape us to be a little bit more like Jesus Christ. And so, Holy God, we pray today, may your name be lifted up, may you be glorified, and may you be honored. Father, hear our prayer as we bring it to you in and through the name of Jesus. Amen.
Now, how great, how
Now, we all love a good story, don't we? Stories form an important part of our lives. And actually, the scriptures are basically the story of God and our story intertwining. And there are lots of different stories even within the biblical narrative. And one of those ones that has been picked up on and become very much a favourite is the story of Joseph, as it's found in the book of Genesis. And of course, we all know about the West End production, Joseph and his amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. Well, today, I want us to focus on this story. And I'm going to be focusing later on one particular part towards the end of the story. But before that, I want to remind you through readings and other ways of this story of Joseph and to get into it. And maybe after we've finished this time of online worship, you might want to go and read through that story again and ask God to speak to you through it in perhaps a different way. So we're going to start now with an introduction. We're going to be reminding ourselves of this story of Joseph. And so we pick up right from the beginning. So Joe is going to read to us now from the book of Genesis, beginning this epic story of Joseph.
Hello, church. Today's Bible reading is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 37, verses 1 through 11, and it's entitled Joseph's Dreams. Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed, the land of Canaan. This is the account of Jacob's family line. Joseph, a man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brother, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of the other sons, because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made an ornate robe for him. When his brothers saw that the father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen to the dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it." His brothers said to him, "Do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule over us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he had said. Then he had another dream, and he told it to his brothers. "Listen," he said, "I had another dream, and this time the sun and moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me." When he told his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. Amen.
Thank you, Joe. Well, it's time once again for more of your cheery, chuckle-tastic chortlers. It's time for Chuck It In The Bucket!
Chuck It In The Bucket!
Well, let's see what we've got in store for you today. Well, actually, Tim, I didn't tell you this, but a man knocked on my door the other day and asked for a small donation towards the local swimming pool.
Did you give him anything?
Yeah, I gave him a glass of water. Oh, what have we got next? Something else I'm not sure if you're aware, Tim, but I've actually got an extra job. I found a job helping a one-armed typist do capital letters.
Oh, how's it going?
Well, you know, it's shift work. Oh, dear, dear. Final one for today. Here we go. I've just heard that my boss is going to fire the employee with the worst posture.
Oh no, that's not good.
No, I've had a hunch it might be me. Oh, it took a while to sink in that one, didn't it? I've a hunch it might be me. Well, probably maybe have some more of those another time. We're going to carry on now with the story of Joseph, and Stewie's going to bring us the next instalment in that story before Terry leads us in our time of prayer. And then we're going to carry the story of Joseph on with two mini movie cartoons and in between them a song. So we'll see you in a few moments' time.
Morning, Church. This morning's reading is from Genesis chapter 37, verses 12 to 28, and it's subheaded, Joseph sold by his brothers. Now his brothers had gone to graze their father's flocks near Shechem, and Israel said to Joseph, "As you know, your brothers are grazing the flocks near Shechem. Come, I am going to send you to them." "Very well," he replied. So he said to him, "Go and see if all is well with your brothers and with the flocks, and bring word back to me." Then he sent him off from the valley of Hebron. When Joseph arrived at Shechem, a man found him wandering around in the fields and asked him, "What are you looking for?" He replied, "I'm looking for my brothers. Can you tell me where they are grazing their flocks?" "They have moved on from here," the man answered. "I heard them say, 'Let's go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them near Dothan. But they saw him in the distance, and before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. "Here comes the dreamer," they said to each other. "Come, now let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams." When Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. "Let's not take his life," he said. "Don't shed any blood. Throw him into this cistern here in the wilderness, but don't lay a hand on him." Reuben said this to rescue him from them and to take him back to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the ornate robe he was wearing, and they took him and threw him into the cistern. The cistern was empty. There was no water in it. As they sat down to eat their meal, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balms, and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he is our brother, our own flesh and blood." His brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt. Stay safe, everybody. Look forward to seeing you all in the not too distant future. God bless.
Hello everyone. Before we get into our prayer, I'd like to share a Bible scripture with you. This one is taken from Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. It tells us to trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your paths straight. Saints, our God we serve is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8 tells us. The same God who was thousands of years ago is the same God today. He has not changed for any one of us. He is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your love, your unfailing love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for the wisdom you have given us. We ask in the name of Jesus to fill us afresh, to guide us, to protect us. We ask in the name of Jesus to open our ears to hear you, to open our hearts to receive your word in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray this day, Father Lord, casting all our cares, our burdens, our worries and anxieties to you, Father Lord, in the name of Jesus. Your word says you will never leave us nor forsake us. You will be with us till the end of the ages, and we must trust in you. Oh Lord, we thank you, Father Lord, for each and every day you have given us. Oh Lord, every day is a blessing. The breath of fresh air you have put in our lungs, we thank you. Oh Lord, as we sit or as we stand or as we raise our holy hands, Father Lord, we ask you to ignite us in the holy fire. Lord, we ask you to put a hedge of fire around us in the name of Jesus. We ask you in the mighty name of Jesus to put on the whole spiritual armor that we may stand strong, stand firm against any tricks and plans of the devil. Oh Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that your windows of heaven may be opened, that blessings may be poured upon us. Lord, we want to trust you each and every day. We look for wisdom in your word, Father Lord. We dip into the word of God, seeking your face, seeking your presence, seeking your blessings, Father Lord. We knock on your door, Father Lord. We ask in the name of Jesus to guide us in this time. Oh Lord, we pray, Father Lord, for the sick. We pray for the weak. We pray for the homeless. We pray for the jobless. We pray for all those who are persecuted for your name's sake, Father Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. That they may be restored, that they may be redeemed, that they may be comforted in this time. We pray, Father Lord, for your blessing upon those, Father Lord, who are asking you for help in certain situations, certain circumstances, Father Lord. We ask you to bless them and guide them in the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, we ask you in the mighty name of Jesus that as you fill us afresh, Father Lord, let us see your manifestation of power flowing through us, Father Lord, that we may be a blessing unto others in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for all you are doing. Thank you, Lord, for all you've done. Thank you, Lord, for what you're about to do in our lives, in our families' lives, in our homes, in our friends, Father Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray for the medical staff. We pray for the NHS. We pray for the doctors, the nurses, Father Lord. We pray that you strengthen them, Father Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray for the teachers. We pray for our children. We pray for those parents who are working at home with their children as well. We ask in the name of Jesus to give them strength, wisdom, and knowledge. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Oh, Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that as we walk, you walk with us, guiding us, protecting us, Father Lord, in the name of Jesus. I want to pray as well for the fathers out there, Father Lord. We pray, Father Lord, that you may give them that strength, Father Lord, that they may be the head of their homes, Father Lord, in the name of Jesus. We pray for the wives as well, Father Lord, that they may be their right hand, Father Lord, lifting them up in the name of Jesus Christ through this time. Lord, in this time, Father Lord, we ask you that you may strengthen us and guide us, that we do not fall in the ditch, Father Lord, because you are with us. Lord, you never sleep nor slumber. You are a God of mercy, a God of grace, and we thank you. So, Lord, we ask you to bless us, to guide us, protect us. We ask you, Father Lord, in the name of Jesus, to strengthen us during this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Lord, we love you. Lord, we honor you for who you are, Christ Jesus, the same yesterday, today, and forever. We bless your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, folks. Have a good day. In Jesus' name, amen, amen.
This is Joseph.
Hey!
Who was the son of Israel and Rachel.
Ah.
He was his father's favorite, so his brothers hated him and sold him into slavery.
Yep.
You see, Joseph was taken to Egypt, and Potiphar, one of the Pharaoh's officials, bought him for his household. God was with Joseph, and he did well in Potiphar's house.
Oh!
Potiphar saw that God made everything Joseph did a success.
Aha!
So he put Joseph in charge of his whole house.
Yeah!
And God blessed Potiphar's house because of this. Potiphar's wife saw how well Joseph was doing in the house, and she wanted to make him do bad things. Joseph ran away from her because he wanted nothing to do with someone who would try to make him do the wrong thing. This made Potiphar's wife angry, and she wanted to be rid of Joseph.
Huh?
So she lied and made Potiphar believe that Joseph had done the bad things that she wanted him to do. Potiphar burned with anger against Joseph and sent him to prison. While Joseph was in prison, again, he did well and the warden soon made him responsible for all that was done there. God was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. When 2 full years had passed, Pharaoh was having unsettling dreams. Pharaoh did not understand his dreams, so he sent for Joseph. Pharaoh asked Joseph to tell him the meaning of his dreams. With God's help, Joseph told Pharaoh that the dreams told of what could come in the future, and he explained all the dreams to the Pharaoh. Pharaoh believed that what Joseph was saying was true. He trusted Joseph as a wise man, and he put him in charge of the land of Egypt, of Pharaoh's palace, and of all his people. This is Joseph, who was the son of Israel and Rachel. But he had 11 brothers who hated him and sold him into slavery. After being put in jail, Joseph told of the future of Egypt when he interpreted Pharaoh's dreams. And Joseph found favor with the Pharaoh. The Pharaoh made Joseph a leader in his kingdom. Just as Joseph had told the Pharaoh, Egypt had 7 years of abundance. Then the 7 years of abundance came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began. Just as Joseph had said. But the Egyptians had food to eat because Joseph had planned for the famine. There was famine in all the other lands, and many came to Joseph to buy food. There was even a famine in the land that Joseph came from. So when Israel heard that there was grain in Egypt, he sent his sons to buy some.
Yeah!
But Israel did not send Benjamin with the others.
Aww.
Because he was afraid that harm might come to him. When Joseph's brothers came to him, Joseph recognized them. But he pretended to be a stranger.
Aha!
So Joseph decided to test his brothers. He had his interpreter tell them to send for Benjamin, who had stayed home.
Him.
And then he threw his brothers in jail for 3 days. On the third day, Joseph let all but one of the brothers take grain to their starving households with the instruction to bring Benjamin back. But Joseph provided for his brothers' journey and gave them grain and silver. The brothers did exactly as Joseph instructed, as they were scared that God was punishing them for what they had done to Joseph so many years before. They traveled home to their father's house,
yippee!
Then back to Egypt. Now that he had seen that they brought Benjamin, Joseph was overwhelmed, so he released the brother who was still in prison.
Yeah.
But Joseph decided to play one more trick on his brothers. He sent the brothers away but told his servant to hide his silver cup in Benjamin's bag. Then Joseph told the servant to go after the brothers and retrieve the cup. The brothers hadn't traveled far before the servant stopped them and accused them of stealing the cup.
Well, we've been following through this amazing story of Joseph in the book of Genesis in the Old Testament, and we've come to that point now, which can be found in Genesis chapter 45, where Joseph reveals himself to his brothers in Egypt. And that's what I'm going to be looking at in just a few moments, but in a slightly different way, in a kind of a reflective narrative preach, looking at this revelation, if you like, through the eyes of Judah, one of Joseph's brothers. So we're going to do that in a moment, but before we do, let's share in singing a worship song again.
Alone, somehow I stand where even angels fear to tread. Invited by redeeming love before the throne of God above, He pulls me close. With nail-scarred hands into His everlasting arms, when condemnation grips my heart and Satan tempts me to despair, I hear the voice that scatters fear. Oh, the great I am, the Lord is here. Oh, praise the one who fights for me and shields my soul eternally. Approach your throne. sun. More beauty than this world has known. I'm face to face with love himself. His perfect spotless righteousness.
Time stood still for what to him seemed like an eternity. He had spoken from his heart, pleaded before this great man to spare the beloved youngest son of his father. There was only so much a man could take. Losing Joseph was enough. To lose Benjamin too, well, it would be more than he could let his father bear. He had felt the weight of responsibility for all that had happened for some time now. After all, it had been his suggestion to sell Joseph to the Ishmaelite traders. Why have his blood on our hands when we can make some easy money by selling the dreamer? It'd be the last we'd see of him. Of course, their father would be broken, but life had become intolerable with Joseph around. Now it seemed like everything was coming back on their heads. It was just a simple trip to Egypt to buy some grain. Why did that man have to ask all those questions? How did they end up getting in such a mess? How did that cup end up in Benjamin's sack? Was the Lord paying them back for their sin? It felt like he'd been living a lie now all these years and I could take it no more. He had offered to take Benjamin's place, to remain here as the slave to this governor, second only to Pharaoh in all of Egypt. He couldn't let his father suffer any more than he already had. And he looked at the man stood before him now, this great Egyptian leader. What did he know about suffering? What did he know about a life of struggle and hardship? All of Egypt was his to command, and now the Lord had put their fate, their destiny into his hands as well. The governor of Egypt stood up. He was about to give his decision on the matter. Judah glanced round nervously at his brothers. The years had taken their toll on all of them. He knew that they too carried the weight of guilt over what had happened all those years ago. It had been a secret that had bound them all together through thick and thin, something in which they had all had their part to play. But the burden of what they had done had become, well, just too much for them to bear any longer. He looked back at this great man stood before them. His face seemed to have softened. "Leave my presence!" His loud cry startled them all. And he and his brothers looked around in surprise as all the officials left the room. What was going on? What was happening? As the men left, he turned back to look at Egypt's governor. And what he saw startled him, puzzled him. Tears were streaming down the man's face. And as he dropped slowly to his knees, he began to wail loudly. He looked at his brothers and he sensed that they too seemed to share his sense of awkwardness, of bewilderment. What was happening? "I am Joseph," the man cried. "Is my father still living?" "Joseph? How could this be? Joseph?" He felt a numbness sweep over his body and he watched as the sobbing man before him removed his headdress and cast it aside. It was Joseph. Fear began to well up inside him as he thought about the man before him whom they'd sold like a common slave, the one whose life they had destroyed, their own flesh and blood. This man standing before them as Lord of all Egypt. He felt numb, dumbfounded. How could this be? As he looked at his brothers, he sensed their share of shock and fear. Had God preserved Joseph to bring punishment on them? Yes, of course. Joseph was to be the Lord's chosen vessel of wrath against them for their sin. Surely they will be added to their own guilt and the burden of the guilt, the vengeance of the Lord through this, their own brother. The pit into which they had cast him would become their own. They stood together as brothers, speechless, condemned, guilty. "Come close to me," he said to them. Judah looked at his brothers, trying to perceive with them what was going on. Was Joseph not angry with them for what they had done? Was he playing games? And yet the tears,
They all seemed as perplexed as he did. He looked back at the weeping man before him, his brother. He took a step towards him, wanting to believe, wanting to embrace him, wanting it to be all right again. Could it be? Joseph held out his arms to them. I am your brother, Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. Listen, don't be angry with yourselves about what you did to me, for it was really God who did it. He sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. These 2 years of famine will grow to 7, and there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God has sent me here to keep you and your families alive so that you will become a great nation. Yes, it was God who sent me here, not you. And he's made me a counselor to Pharaoh, manager of his entire household and ruler over all Egypt. You must return to my father and tell him what I have said. Tell him that God has made me master over all the land of Egypt. Tell him to come to me right away. And you, yes, all of you, you will come and live in the land of Goshen, a land of plenty, so you can be near me with your grandchildren and your children, your flocks and your herds and all that you have. I will take care of you so that you will not become destitute. In that moment, as Judah looked into the face of Joseph, he felt a tear run down his cheek. He ran to him, embraced him, and wept. He wept over what he had done. He cried tears of repentance. He wept as he released the burden of his sin. He wept over the realization that he could receive forgiveness, that the one he had abused and abandoned wanted to embrace him. For his brother, his own flesh and blood, the one who had been despised and rejected, had now been exalted to the highest place and become God's servant in bringing salvation. And Had the Lord been in all of this all along? Was what Joseph said really true? Could the Lord really turn all that had been done to good? Was it almost too wonderful to believe that it was God's will to turn all the chaos and shame of their sin to his own gracious purpose? And he wept. He wept. Tears of joy. Was it possible that through this man that they had rejected, God would provide for their needs, that the hungry would be filled in a land of plenty, that there would be singing once again, that gladness and joy would overtake them and sorrow and sighing would flee away? And he wept. And as he wept, the light began to dawn. This great deliverance had been the Lord's doing all the time. God was to turn his poverty to riches. He himself, the one who'd been imprisoned with guilt, fear, and shame, could know release and freedom. Now he could see he was to be released from his oppression. God had worked all things for good through the one who now stood before him. Yes, surely this was the year of the Lord's favor for him and for his brothers. And he wept. Today, you and I are like Judah. And our sin and rebellion led to the one who came to share our flesh and blood being abandoned, despised, and rejected. Not in a pit, but on a cross. You and I are like Judah. We stand in the Lord's presence and we're reminded that we've not loved him as we should, that we have done things that have wounded and hurt him, things that we may be ashamed of. You and I are like Judah. If we recognize that the despised and rejected one has been raised by God to the highest place, and that through him God brings our rescue and salvation. You and I are like Judah because we are in the presence of the one who bore the cost of our sin, who with arms wide open has beckoned us to come and know his forgiveness and experience in our lives the blessings that he wants to pour upon us. You and I are like Judah. God is working his purpose in and through our story too, for our good, even when we cannot see it. You and I are like Judah if we gratefully come, recognizing God's amazing grace in saving us through the one who shared our flesh and blood, even when we were blind and lost. You and I are like Judah. His grace has relieved our fears. Our chains are gone, and we've been set free.
Amazing grace, how sweet that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been saved.
Like a
the earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever.
And so now, may the strength of God guide us, the power of God preserve us, the wisdom of God instruct us, the Spirit of God be within us, this day and evermore. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and remain on you all, this week and always. Amen. Really pleased you could join us, and we look forward to seeing you next time. God bless and take care.